Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm Matt Shea, President and CEO of the National Retail Federation, and very happy to have you joining us for this week's conversation with retail CEOs, our NRF Retail Leadership Series. And today, our guest is Brian Cornell, the Chairman and CEO of Target. So we're delighted to have you with us. Also want to thank today's sponsor, eMarsys, marketing software provider, and appreciate their help with this session today, and the chance to give them some visibility on their customer engagement platform that's really helped many retailers drive foot traffic during the COVID-19 pandemic. And as I said, very, very happy to, in this now fifth of our conversations, be joined by Brian. And as you all know, Brian, as Chairman and CEO of Target, leads a team of 350,000 team members, 1,900 stores, nearly $80 billion in sales. And he's been with Target almost 6 years, since the summer of 2014. And I actually remember where I was when I read the news that that Brian had been announced as the new CEO of Target, done an amazing job building a great team and delivering incredible value for the communities that Target serves, and so many opportunities for their associates, which we will talk about. And we really wanted to have Brian talk not only about what Target has experienced over these last 3 months during the pandemic, but of course also closer to home, the terrible events surrounding the killing of George Floyd right in their hometown, and how Target is helping communities respond and heal and move forward from that, and what we see in the future for retail and for Target. So I would like to just invite Brian to turn on his camera and his microphone and join us. Good morning.
Matt, good morning.
Thank you for being here. I want to also remind everyone that when we get to the Q&A portion, feel free to submit your questions through the Q&A function, and I'll get those when we get to the question and answer session, which we'll try to devote the second half of our conversation to that. So Brian, it's great to see you. Thank you for being with us. You and I have had many conversations over the past weeks, and obviously our heart goes out to your community and to the family of George Floyd and the aftermath of his killing. And maybe we could just start there. You know, you put out a very a moving and I thought poignant note to your team the weekend after George Floyd was killed, beginning with "We are a community in pain," and then finishing with "We will meet pain with purpose." And I wonder if maybe you could just talk to us a little bit about how you're doing and how you're working through this together.
Well, Matt, thanks for having us today. And, you know, I certainly appreciate the time to talk to this group. I guess going back to that day on May 25th, when many of us saw the video of George Floyd's murder for the first time. Now, I know when I saw it and I saw some of the protests and the activities that were breaking out in Minneapolis and then protests across the country and finally the world. But my initial reaction was that could have been one of Target's team members. And when I watched that video, that was the very first thing that came to mind. Recognizing that there was violence and demonstrations breaking out immediately afterwards, you know, our second reaction was to pull our team together and make sure that we were focused on the safety of our team. And obviously many of you have seen in the background, you know, the destruction of Target stores in Minneapolis. And while our stores were under attack, we wanted to make sure we took care of the safety of our team. My third reaction was a need to reach out and listen to our African-American team members. And almost immediately after the death of George Floyd, I pulled together a group of African-American officers. And it was a Zoom call just like this, Matt, except it was very different. because every box was filled with tears and tremendous emotion and pain. But it was an opportunity for me to listen to our team, understand what they were facing. We followed that up with a Zoom call that was led by our African American Business Council that had over 7,000 participants. And it was a chance for all of us to listen to their stories. And the stories weren't new to me. I've heard them again and again. I heard stories about some of our store leaders who get pulled over all the time as they're going from one Target store to another. Why? Because they're Black. I've heard the stories of leaders that we've relocated into a new community that are out with their families looking for a new home, and they get pulled over. And the offense was simply being Black. Or team members who live in different communities where we operate, who at the end of the day go out for a run, and as they get back home and go in their home a few hours later, there are policemen walking around. Why? Because they were Black. So the stories weren't new, but I think for all of us, we said, it's enough. We have to drive change. And we felt it was really important to make sure that as a company that deeply believes in our purpose. And when we talk about purpose at Target, we talk about things like helping all families discover a little bit of joy, and that all family component's really important. And we said, you know, we're gonna lead through this painful time reflecting on our purpose. And that all component is about the inclusive nature of our brand. And we wanted to make sure we were really clear about that. We wanted to be really declared about the fact that at Target, we do not support or tolerate racism. And we wanted to make sure that our Black families knew we were standing there with them. So we took a very definitive stance. We immediately donated $10 million to some of the organizations that we've supported in the past, the Urban League, the African American Leadership Forum. We said we were going to help small businesses and donate 10,000 hours of consulting and advice to getting those small businesses back up and running. And we made a really important commitment early on that we were going to rebuild those downtown Minneapolis stores. That one store has been there since 1976. It's vitally important to the neighborhood. And we wanted to make sure everyone knew we were going to be back in business as soon as possible. As a byproduct of some of the listening, some of the learning along the way, we've recently stood up our own internal task force that's focused on racial equality. And they're going to work internally, help guide us externally as we think about the right steps to take with our own team in our community of Minneapolis and also on a national level. And I've recently joined a special committee that the Business Roundtable has put together focused on racial equality. So we don't have all the answers, but we felt it was really important to make sure our position was clear. We were committing to our purpose, the inclusive nature of our brands that serve all families in America, that we were really clear we will not tolerate racism, and we were going to stand next to the Black families as we look to make bold changes across the country.
Yeah, I remember speaking with you right after this, that last weekend in May, and just the words and the emotion and the commitment this time from leaders across our economy, across the retail industry. There's a deeper level of commitment to change now, and it does feel like there's momentum that we will all hold ourselves accountable to. And we've been pleased to work with you and other retail leaders on these projects. And it seems to me that given the number of Americans whose lives are touched by retail, large, medium, and small businesses, those 50 million Americans that find employment opportunities throughout the retail industry, that we have a unique and a special role that we can play there. And
I think we do. I think, you know, the role that NRF can play, the role that others that are on the call can play. I think we all have an opportunity to come together and make sure our voices are heard and we help drive reform and change across the country.
Well, one of the, one of the ways that you have really supported throughout the last few weeks, but also throughout the pandemic, supported success across the enterprise is the investments you've made in your team. And you made some very big announcements just this week, as you have throughout the last several months, but in particular, the announcement of $1 billion commitment of all team members now with a starting wage of $15 an hour, and the other investments you've made in terms of bonuses and additional support. That's really an extraordinary commitment, both a statement of faith in the value of those team members, or recognition that it really is all about people, as well as a real financial commitment. And among the things you've said is that there's not a more important asset than your team members. And maybe you could talk a little bit about both what you've announced this week and the investments that you've been making in the team going back really since the beginning of your tenure at Target.
Well, Matt, I think we've always said that our biggest asset and our biggest point of differentiation has been our team. And for many, many years now, we've been making investments in our team, in wages and training and career opportunities. But as we entered the pandemic and when Target was recognized as a essential service and essential retailer is going to operate, we didn't have a playbook for this. There was no financial algorithm that we could reflect on. But we said, if we're going to serve America during the pandemic, we better make sure we start by taking care of our team and investing in safety, investing in pay and benefits. So we took a number of safety measures, and you and I have talked about, we've shared some of the things that we've done, from making sure that we put plexiglass shields up and put decals on the floor, recommending social distancing, metering the number of guests in our stores at any one time, elevating our focus on cleaning surfaces, and ensuring that our team members had masks and gloves every time they came to work. But beyond the safety component, we recognized that we had to lean into additional pay and benefits. And during the pandemic, we put a premium pay in of $2 for all of our store and supply chain team members. For anyone who was 65 or older, was pregnant, had a pre-existing condition, we offered them 4 weeks paid leave. With so many of our team members with children that were now being educated at home, we extended backup care for those team members. And we've done that throughout the pandemic. And we extended those offerings a number of times. But if I go all the way back, Matt, to February of 2017, when we talked more broadly about the investments we were making in our company, in our stores, and our team, we made a commitment back then to get to a starting minimum wage of $15 an hour. And under the circumstances, the importance of our team, we've decided to pull that forward and make it effective on July 5th. So I think it's just so important. And I'm so thankful to the team for the work that they've done as they've supported our guests, supported Americans throughout this crisis. We wanted to make sure we continue to support them with the right pay and benefit program. And while I've been challenged a few times by retail analysts, I will not apologize for the investments and the $1 billion we're investing in our team during these unprecedented times where we're operating.
Yeah, well, it's an extraordinary commitment and obviously something that you believe in. It's not new because it goes back to the beginning of your arrival at Target, and a recognition that this was a real opportunity to create a competitive advantage by making these investments. You mentioned that there's not a playbook for what we've experienced over the past few months, and all of this had to be done, this accelerated change to new ways of operating and protecting teams and serving customers and implementing new technologies and protocols. And you've reported some pretty extraordinary performance over the past few weeks, over the last couple of months. Could you talk a little bit about those results and what you've experienced in terms of the way you've been able to perform and serve those customers and take care of those communities?
Well, Matt, when we reported our first quarter results, we talked about overall comp store sales of 10.8%. You know, our digital business grew by 141%. We talked about the fact that our same day fulfillment offerings grew by close to 300%. But if I break it down for you, as I think all of us know, it changed almost week by week. If I go back to February, when I talked about our results, for us, February was somewhat of a normal month. Now, our comps grew just short of 4%. Our digital business was up about 33%. Our guests and consumers were shopping all of our categories. And then as we got towards the end of February, into the start of March, America started to hear about travel restrictions. We started to hear about schools closing. Obviously, we saw the pandemic spike in Seattle. And the world started to change. I've told this story a number of times. We had our annual investor conference scheduled for March 3rd. And originally, we were going to be in New York. In fact, I had flown out early to get ready. And on a Saturday afternoon, I got on the phone with a couple of our leaders. And we said, you know what, it's probably not the right thing to do to ask several hundred people to get into a room with us. So let's do it remotely. And we went back and we held the meeting remotely. And at that time, I had one only question about the virus. And it was, how's it affecting our supply chain in China?
Yeah.
We literally got off the call, and it seemed like within 24 hours, the reports started in Seattle. Travel restrictions went into place. Major sports were stopped. Schools were closed. And in March, we saw this rush to our stores, and it was to our stores to buy all those household essentials, to buy medication, to buy the food and beverage products that consumers needed. A couple of weeks later, as we all learned what sheltering in place was, we started to see a very different behavior. And while those stock of essentials were still important, we were learning how to work from home and educate from home, as well as entertain our families from home. And we saw a very different shopping behavior. Big surge in household essentials, but now people are also buying office supplies and printers and new electronic products and things for their kitchens and games and videos for their family. When later in March, we heard the administration recommend to Americans that, one, you should limit your time in public, and if you're out, you should wear a mask. We saw our digital business surge. And during our report, we talked about the fact that we had weeks where our drive-up business was growing 500, 600, 700%. And when guests were in our stores, they were wearing masks. So big changes. In April, and I'm sure many of us have seen this, once those stimulus checks arrived, consumer behavior changed again. And we talked about on our call, in April, our comps grew by over 16%. And stores came back to life. And people were buying apparel again and shopping all of our categories. So we've seen kind of the ebb and flow every week. And from a leadership standpoint and from a team standpoint, we've learned to be really adaptable and flexible and nimble, because every week's been different during the pandemic. And we've been talking about different chapters. I know, and I think you do, there's more chapters to be written. And we're not sure what the balance of the summer is going to look like, how the economy is going to recover. Is there a second wave? There's so many new dynamics that we're putting a premium on being really responsive, really agile, really flexible. And we're taking a much shorter term horizon as we think about the business.
Well, that's it's just been an incredible few months to watch the transformation of your business and so many others, and the way in which teams have responded. It seems a little counterintuitive, though, almost, when you think about an environment in which 85 or 90% of your sales are driven by stores, and yet you had this incredible success on the digital side of the business. And I wonder, you know, it was only a few years ago that you, relatively early in your time as CEO, made a big bet and a big investment in placing stores at the center of the strategy. And at the time, I think I seem to recall that not everyone necessarily bought into that vision. And yet the stores here seem to be the heroes over the last few months and over the last several years.
Well, Matt, for several years now, you know, we've been working on a strategy that put really the stores in the center of everything we do, including our digital fulfillment. And if I go back to some of the things we were testing in 2015 and 2016, an announcement we made at our annual investor conference back in February 2017, when we talked about investing $7 billion of capital to remodel hundreds and hundreds of stores, to build new small stores in urban markets and on college campuses, to invest in our brand, to use our stores as our fulfillment hubs. Many people, I would say 99.9%, were shaking their heads. They didn't understand an environment where many were closing stores, were building big upstream distribution centers. Yeah. Why would we at Target invest in our stores, put capital into remodeling, open up new stores when others were closing? And how are we going to meet the needs of digital fulfillment by using our stores? Yeah. As I sit here today, I think we've changed many minds. And I think during the pandemic, this might have been the stress test for our system to say, can we actually keep up with digital demand and grow our business by over 140%, but grow those same day fulfillment elements by almost 300%. But you know, years and years of investment in technology and process engineering and training and development, I think we were able to step up, and our teams did an incredible job and continue to do a great job of serving our guests.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you say 99.9% were non-believers. I mean, it's difficult with all the things that have transpired in the past few years, and in particular in the past few weeks, of course. It's very difficult to think back to 2016 or the third or fourth quarter of 2017. It was the retail ice age. It was the retail apocalypse. Stores were closing. Stores were dinosaurs. And yet in that environment, you made that commitment and that investment. And I remember also being with you in November of 2018 when I came up for a visit. And at that time, the consumer was in such a great place. And I think you had said a couple of times publicly that you'd never seen a better consumer environment maybe in your career. And we talked about in an environment like that, just because the consumer's in a great place, a success is not distributed equally across all competitors in the marketplace. And I said, well, how much of your current success do you attribute to the strength of the consumer versus the investments that you've been making, not just for 6 months or 1 year, but investments going back years, things that you've been planning that take time to bring to scale. And maybe you could talk a little bit about that, because right now you've had great success this quarter, the month of April, over the last year, but it didn't happen overnight. This was a journey that required vision and planning and investments that have unfolded over 5 years, 6 years.
Well, Matt, along the way, we've been testing really carefully. We've been iterating. You know, I think about our remodel journey. We started out with 25 stores in Los Angeles that were our test labs. And we got a lot of consumer feedback. We got feedback from our guests. We got feedback from our team. And we made constant changes. And we went from 25 stores to testing 110 remodels until we proved out the model and then said, all right, we can start remodeling 300 stores at a time. We opened up a couple of small formats. We had to learn how to operate in a smaller environment. Mm-hmm. We're used to stores that had at least 100,000 square feet. Now we're in stores that might have 20 or 30,000. So we had to learn how to curate assortment, how to staff, how to fulfill those stores. So we've been in a testing and learning mode for years, and that actually continues. I think one of the reasons behind our success has been a combination of testing and learning, but staying really focused, putting a premium on guest feedback, but also a premium on execution. And for us, one of the things that is a challenge is we do have 1,900 stores and we operate in all 50 states. So we can do anything in 10 locations, particularly if it's in Minneapolis, but we got to do it 1,900 times and deliver that same great guest experience, whether you're in Washington, D.C. or Seattle, Washington. And we've got to make sure that what we do is driven by the guest, is supported by our teams, but it's a real premium on execution and constantly learning and iterating. That first remodel in Los Angeles looks very different from the stores we remodeled at the start of 2020. Yeah. Some of those first stores, the smaller formats that we had in Minneapolis, they look a lot different than the ones we've opened up recently in DC or New York. So we've got to constantly be listening to the consumer during good economic times and bad, understanding what they're looking for from our brand, but making sure, you know, we continue to deliver a consistent experience that has both that touch of inspiration, but ease and value that our guests have come to expect from Target.
Well, and that's maybe a good place to segue into the guests and expectations and behavior. You know, we've talked about, and there's been a lot written and said about the kind of change that's taken place just over the past few months. And I don't usually quote Vladimir Lenin, but his old quote that there are decades where there are no changes, and then there are weeks where there are decades of change. And this feels like a few months where there've been decades of change. And I wonder if you have any thoughts on, as consumer behavior has evolved in the past, how much of this will sustain itself? How much of this will be sticky and will be a permanent or sort of a ratcheting up of behavior that pulls us forward, you know, 5 years in a few months, in terms of changed behavior online and delivery and fulfillment and all of the things that you've seen? How do you think about that?
Well, I don't have a crystal ball, but as I think about perhaps the next 18 months and beyond, Matt, I think there's three or four elements that coming out of the pandemic will be sticky. I certainly think during the pandemic, millions and millions of Americans have learned how to shop online. And we reported during our first quarter results, we had 5 million new users of Target.com. We had 2 million new guests who discovered our drive up lane. I expect them to continue to use those services. And I think we're going to see a consumer who continues to enjoy stores, but also knows that they have these convenient options, particularly same day options, where people don't want to wait. They like the ability to place an order at noon and at 2 o'clock, they can come by and pick it up or drive by and we'll put it in their trunk or have one of our shipped shoppers across the country go shopping for you and within 2 hours, put it on your front door. Yeah. So I think that acceleration and comfort in shopping online will only continue. I do think coming out of the pandemic, there's gonna be an even greater focus on safety. And for years, I talked about internally, one of our goals was to become America's easiest place to shop.
Yeah.
I've now challenged our team to say, how do we become the safest place to shop? Yeah. And how do we make sure throughout the shopping experience, we're thinking about safety, we're thinking about how we have contact-free solutions, we make it easy, but a sense of trust and confidence that when you're shopping in a store, it's safe, and I feel good in that environment. So I think this focus on safety and minimizing contact is something that's going to come out of this pandemic. I certainly expect that with the challenges we're seeing in the economy, there's going to be a continued focus on value, and the consumer is going to be looking to combine the ease of shopping online and the safety we can offer with a focus on value. And more as I look at the survey data, I think we're seeing an American consumer who's looking to consolidate the number of places they shop. And it's where, for us, our multi-category portfolio, the fact that we have this balanced business between apparel and home, hard lines with toys and electronics, beauty and household essentials, and food and beverage, I think that gives us an advantage and certainly allows us to meet consumer needs by giving them one place where they can consolidate their purchases. But we're all going to have to watch this really carefully, because I think there are going to be lasting changes coming out of the pandemic. And I've talked a lot about it. I think we're going to step back a few years from now and recognize, as a byproduct of the pandemic, it's changed the way Americans live, the way they work, the way they shop. And I think it's going to really emphasize their personal values. And I think we're all going to have to adjust to the changing consumer needs.
So safety, convenience, your ability to deliver safe experience, the easiest place to shop, the convenience, and the opportunity to make it a one-stop shop to find those multi categories in a single place. Seems like that would be
probably, Matt, punctuated with one other term. And I think as I look at our recent success and certainly the response we saw from America during the pandemic, I think trust is going to be really important for all of us, and making sure we're building trust with the consumer, in Target's case, trust with the guests we serve. I think that trust word is going to be a really important area of focus for successful retailers for the years to come.
Yeah, we've talked about that, and it seems to me, and everything that you have said, I think would confirm that in many ways, safety is sort of the new brand commitment, the new brand promise, and consumers, each of us as consumers, don't want it only to be sort of what you see at the store. You want to believe that it runs through to the very culture of the organization, that it's not just what you see on the surface, but it's really embedded in the culture. I wonder, you know, you talked about the fulfillment and the curbside pickup and all the ways in which you're driving convenience. Can you share a little bit on how that can be done sort of profitably? I mean, how much efficiency can you gain doing those things with the store at the center of this versus the traditional method of e-commerce or digital fulfillment? And can you talk about how that has evolved as well?
And I've talked about this a couple of times publicly, Matt. So when we've talked to investors about our model with stores at the hub, one of the things we started out by sharing was when we move from fulfilling a digital order from an upstream distribution center to picking, prepping, packing, and shipping from our store, about 40% of the cost goes away. And that's largely the transportation cost. Mm-hmm. When we can use our footprint across most of America and partner with UPS or FedEx to deliver that last mile, using our store as that distribution point versus a DC upstream, we see about 40 points of the cost go away. When the guest actually uses our same day services, when they order online and pick up in our store or use our drive up lane or use a ship shopper, about 90% of the expense goes away. So there's a marginal increase in expense for us, but it looks and acts much more like a store transaction. Yeah. And in fact, the stores do all the work. So we've actually started to get to a point where we're talking more and more about our store fulfilled comps, you know, the productivity that's happening in our stores, because they're the center of all of our work. Over 80% of all of our digital fulfillment is done by our stores. Mm-hmm. And we're a scale business now. In the first quarter alone, we did close to $3 billion of online sales. But the vast majority of that was someone ordering online and picking up in one of our stores, or driving to the Target store and we put it in your trunk, or a ship shopper did the shopping for you in our store and drove a mile to your home. So we're much more focused on the store productivity and how we make sure that we leverage that asset and continue to take cost out by driving greater efficiency and also rewarding the guests with the immediacy of same day. Because back to trends, we're seeing more and more, and certainly during the pandemic, the consumer didn't want to wait 2 or 3 days. Back to trust, they wanted the confidence and trust that they knew when they placed the order for something that they absolutely needed. Well, they could come to our store and pick it up, or they could drive into the parking lot and pop the trunk, and we put it in their trunk within 2 minutes. Or a friendly ship shopper would be at their door, ringing the doorbell, saying your order's here, and there's no contact required. Yeah. So we certainly think that's going to be an ongoing trend, but the economics of that business look very different for us versus shipping eaches from an upstream DC.
Right. Yeah, that's I had heard you describe that before, but I just thought for all of the audience, I think it's just fascinating how the promise of store fulfillment has really become much more economically feasible and driven out some of the costs because of the things you've adopted. So with stores everywhere, literally in the United States, with 1,900 stores and 350,000 team members, it's clear that you're succeeding, you're serving customers. But I know I've heard you talk more than once about the fact that while you want to be competitive and be successful, that you want to see the retail industry broadly, small businesses, medium-sized businesses also succeed, that you talk about the entire retail ecosystem. And you've been personally very involved with congressional leaders, with the administration throughout the pandemic, and really throughout your career at Target and before, being engaged in the policy process and those important discussions that take place. How are you thinking about the rest of the retail industry and in particular smaller businesses that are so important to our economy broadly, but also obviously are important to Target and to your associates and to your own success?
Man, I always start with the fact that there are 50 million jobs in this country that are attached to the retail industry. And we play such an important role. And I just reflect on some of the conversations you and I have had with the Treasury Secretary over the last few months, just reminding him that retail plays such an important role in the economic health of America. And we're not just talking about big companies like Target, it's all of those small retailers that are so important to the fabric of the local community. So I felt it was really important for all of us and for me as the CEO of Target to play a role on behalf of the industry, making sure we're advocating for the industry, for the important role the industry plays. And I certainly appreciate the partnership that you and I have had in talking to members of the administration, whether it was the battle of the border adjustment tax or what's happened recently, to make sure our voice was heard. But I also reflect on with our own business that with over 30 million guests shopping our stores every week, many of them are employees who work for some of our competition.
Right.
So they may be working for one of our competitors during the day, but they're shopping at Target at night. Yeah. So their prosperity is critically important to the future of our business. But I think we all have an important role. And I think the partnership that you and I have formed together, working with members of the administration to make sure the retail voice is heard and they understand the importance of our industry and the importance of the health of our industry, was something I feel very passionate about.
Yeah, well, we're fortunate to have your leadership and grateful for that partnership. You've been, all the way back to that hearing when you came to testify on the border adjustment tax way back in 2017. So early days.
Yeah, Matt, you told me I was going to be on that stand for an hour. 3 hours and 45 minutes later, I was looking for you when I left the room.
I was long gone by then. I wanted to get out of there quickly. You did great, as always. So as you look ahead to the rest of this year, you talked about maybe the next 18 months, and obviously in this environment, it's incredibly difficult to anticipate and predict demand. And therefore, when you think about inventory and supply, it's challenging to do forecasting. I saw a Deloitte CEO study that came out today that that indicated that more than half of the CEOs of Fortune 500 companies believed that by January of 21, 6 months, 7 months from now, that they would essentially be back to pre-pandemic levels in terms of sales and hiring, and very close. And then the other half approximately thought it would be a year from now, maybe June of 21. But when you think about the fourth quarter, the holiday season, how important that is, and you're doing planning for all of the categories that you've got, obviously that's a lot of this planning and inventory purchasing goes way back to, a year in advance. And I've been to Hong Kong to see Bill Foudy, your president of international sourcing, another terrific member of your team. So how are you thinking about the next couple of quarters going forward and how the business comes back, how you plan for supply chain inventory, how are you doing all those things?
Oddly enough, Matt, I just talked to Bill before we started this call. And again, we're taking a very different approach, recognizing that we've got to be flexible. We've got to place some bets where we have confidence, and we've got to be willing to adjust along the way. You know, I'll take you inside of our boardroom. And I had a virtual shareholder meeting last week and a virtual board meeting. And when I wrapped up our board meeting, I talked to our directors and explained to them that under normal circumstances, all of us operate and have operated for most of our careers in an environment where our long-range plan has a three-year horizon, a four-year horizon, and maybe even a five-year horizon. I said, right now, under these circumstances, my LRP horizon at Target is likely the next 4 weeks. Huh. And we're gonna have to continue to adjust along the way. We're gonna have a Christmas holiday season, and I expect the consumer to actually celebrate Father's Day this weekend and the 4th of July and Labor Day. We're getting reports that back to school is gonna happen and colleges are finding a way to conduct classes in the fall. Mm-hmm. And I think Americans are going to wanna celebrate the holiday season, but I expect it to be different. And I think we're gonna have to be more flexible and we're gonna have to adapt along the way. But whether you're in Bill's role trying to source for the holiday season, or you're a merchant or one of our store operators, I think we've come to recognize the horizon and the window where we can see is much shorter than it used to be. And we're gonna have to constantly adjust and recognize that we'll place a few bets that won't all work out, but we're gonna have to just continue to listen to the consumer, see what's happening in the economy, understand the different trends, and perhaps into early 2021, we're gonna have to operate very differently, but put a premium on great communication, really clear priorities, being much more empathetic and supportive of our teams, and recognizing that we're all doing this, or most of us are dealing with the pandemic, the civil unrest in the country, the economic downturn, and we're working remotely. So the bar is really high. And I think we've just got to be there to support our teams and recognize perfection is not the goal. In fact, I say internally, perfection is actually the enemy. We can't be striving for perfection. Mm-hmm. We've just got to make sure that we adjust and iterate along the way.
Yeah, I think that's a really good observation. As quickly as things are changing and as much as there is that's unknown, that it's almost paralysis to try to achieve perfection, because you don't know better to have a strategy that's 75% accurate and executed at 100% than the other way around. And then you just, as you said, use the agility and the resilience of your team members, which you've really been able to celebrate and adjust as you go. And that's similar to Kevin Johnson of Starbucks has taken a similar sort of monitor and adapt thinking ahead to a conversation I'll have with him sometime soon. So Brian, in that environment, how are you thinking about how do you think about investments if you can't do planning? with the same degree of certainty? How do you work through the sorts of investments you've made over the last 3 or 4 or 5 years? Do those get put on hold now as you redirect resources to be more flexible and agile in the near term? Or how do you, you've got scale, so maybe it's easier for you than some companies to make those decisions. How do you think about that?
And it was one of the changes we made at the start of the pandemic. And I'll go back to my March 3rd investor conference. I laid out guidance for the year, said we were going to spend about $3.5 billion of capital, remodel 300 stores, open up 35 new stores. We talked about rolling out fresh products into our order pickup. And then when the pandemic hit, we said we've got to pause and really put all of our focus on the fundamentals. Support our supply chain and sourcing teams, support our merchants who are buying each and every day, and make it really simple for stores. So we actually paused many of our remodels. And as opposed to 300, we'll probably do 130 and stop. We'll open up probably 15 new stores because this is not a time to be focused on construction. We paused our fresh order pickup literally until the last couple of weeks where we said, all right, we're now ready to do more. But we really tried to make sure we focused on the things that were absolutely essential in this environment and focus on the buy, move, and sell functions and make it as easy and clear to our stores what needed to be done day to day. So we've had to adjust. We're still confident in all those initiatives and we'll pick them back up in 2021. But under these circumstances, we said, we've got to focus on the fundamentals, focus on great execution each and every day, but also make it as simple as possible for our teams. So a focus on ruthless priorities, very clear and consistent communication, and then being great servant leaders and just supporting our teams during this time of crisis.
Yeah, it does seem like for a business that so many people thought a couple of years ago, the apocalypse and the ice age, that we still have millions and millions of jobs here in retail, and that we've seen, obviously we gave up a lot of ground in the first couple of months of the pandemic, but you've seen consumers come right back, and you've seen business cycles throughout your career, recessions and downturns and pullbacks. And to go back to the notion that as we went into this recession, you know, I know you well enough now after these years that you're always optimistic, you're always positive. And every year, you know, whether it was 17 to 18, 18 to 19, 19 to 20, people thought, well, it can't continue. This has got to end at some point. And you would say, no, listen, the fundamentals are good. Our business is in a good place. Consumers are in a good place. So again, this year, we were in that position where the fundamentals of the economy, we were in the 10th year of an economic expansion. And so as we get clarity about the health situation, as we develop a therapeutic or multiple therapeutics, as we work towards a vaccine, how do you think about, I don't know about the recovery, but about consumer resilience, about where you think consumers will be based on what's happening in the external environment, economically, medically, financially, for all your customers and your associates?
Man, I remain really confident about the future of America. And over the course of my career, I've lived in Europe and Asia. I've run businesses in over 60 different countries around the world. I'm always really confident that we live in a country that's very resilient. We learn how to adapt and meet change. And we've got great leadership across our industry. So while we're going to continue to see change, and I talked about those trends around safety and value, you know, some of the consolidation that I expect to take place and the importance of instilling trust. But I know in our industry, we have great leaders, and I continue to look at survey after survey and sit inside of consumers' homes over the years and listen to them talk about how they shop. They still love a great physical retail experience, and they want to be out there discovering. They appreciate great customer service. certainly they're going to use online services, whether it's same day or shipping to their home, more and more. But I continue to be optimistic about the future of retail in the United States. I think we are seeing a separation between winners and losers, those that are investing in the capabilities required to be successful, and combining great stores and a great store experience and exciting product and great service with the convenience that digital offers. But knowing so many of the retail leaders in the United States, I remain confident that we're going to be sitting here, you and I, talking 3 or 4 or 5 years from now about the continued success of the industry and the fact that stores are going to continue to play an important role, and there'll be a growing importance of the digital side of the business. But I don't think it's an either or. I think it's an and. And I think there's an opportunity in this environment for continued success for the industry. And I think you and I both agree the vitality of retail is critically important to the future of the U.S. economy. And I think with leaders like Matt Shea, we'll continue to deliver that message to the administration and to those in Washington that can make a difference.
No, that's that. Yeah, I love the optimism, and I have come to expect lots of it from you, but grounded in a real confidence. And maybe on that point, we could, because you're so passionate about this and so committed, we could finish sort of where we started. And a lot of the questions that I asked came from the audience, and I want to sort of put a couple together and ask one final question. Because I think you would be the first to say we won't succeed unless we bring everyone with us. And you've been, you know, quite committed personally over your entire career, not just at Target, to combating racism. And I guess one of the last questions came in was, what advice do you have for companies on how to think about taking action against racism? And you mentioned your commitment with the Business Roundtable. You've obviously done it, as I said, throughout the career and at Target in a very big way. So maybe you could share. I know you're optimistic about our ability to bring about change and progress here as well.
And I'll start with kind of a lifelong commitment I've had to diversity and inclusion. And it's not because I think it's the right thing to do. It is. But I also connect it to business results. And when I think about some of the companies that I've worked with, whether it's Target today or in the past working for PepsiCo, you know, that common thread was recognizing that diverse and inclusive environments deliver great results.
Yeah.
And I've always tried to ensure that our leadership team, our organization reflected the consumer we serve. And when you get that equation right, it's the right thing for society. It's the right thing for the team. It's also the right thing for business and shareholders. So I think we all have an oversized role to play right now to advance diversity and inclusion, to stand next to our Black leaders who need our support, to make sure it's really clear in our industry and our companies, we're not going to tolerate racism, and to work to make the right changes, both internally and then working as a collective group to make changes in our communities and in our country that are going to have a lasting effect. So I hope we all share that objective to ensure we're making a difference. We're taking care of our teams. We're making a commitment, an even bolder commitment, to diversity and inclusion, and asking the simple questions, you know, how can we help and what can we do differently? So as I said, when I started, we're still spending a lot of time listening and learning and sharing. We don't have all the answers, but I think collectively, we're going to find the right answers. We're going to take the right steps. And I think collectively, Matt, as an industry, we can make a big difference in this country and make a great country even better going forward.
Yeah, I totally agree. And thank you, Brian, for your commitment and for your leadership and your offer to continue to provide us with the resources from which we can all benefit to get better at this together. So. And I've got many, many, many questions in the queue. We're at time, and I want to be respectful of your time and everyone's, but I want to, of course, thank our sponsor, Emarsys, and Brian. I want to thank you and your team for joining us and for such a great conversation, for all you're doing. And thanks for being here. I look forward to many more of these conversations in the future with you. And for everyone that's with us today, we'll be talking to Marvin Ellison of Lowe's and Chris Nassetta of Hilton Hotels, Jeff Gannett of Macy's, and Kevin Johnson of Starbucks over the next few weeks. So look forward to seeing you all again. And Brian, thanks again. Thank you so much for being here.
Man, thanks for having me. Take care now. Stay well.
Thank you. You too. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.